Call our Benefits and Insurance Committee meeting into session. Ms. DePreece, if you would, please call the roll.
Would you like me to
Well, Ms. DePreece brings up a real good position for us to consider. For us, in order to have our quorum, I need to seat our two new members, so that would put us in the position where we could conduct our business. So before we have the roll call, let me introduce our two new members coming on to our committee, and we want to thank each of them for volunteering to give of their time. First, we have Holly Deering. Holly comes to us, lives here in Rutherford County, works for Brown and Brown Insurance, which is primarily a property and casualty and group benefits. Yeah, they do it all. They're one of the larger brokers in the country, but she's worked there for a number of years and has a lot of expertise. So thank you, Holly, for agreeing to come on to the board. Also, we have Eric Tutobini. Eric, I've known for a number of years, lives in the Laverne area. He's in private practice and has a benefit investment type business. He serves on the ECD board at the pleasure of the mayor from Laverne, and works to bring in new businesses and industries into Laverne. So thank you both for agreeing to come and serve on this committee. I think you'll find it very enjoyable, and we look for your input and expertise from your respective backgrounds. These were at-large appointees, citizen at-large appointees, so I am officially seating you. I don't guess we need a motion, but I'm going to do it anyway. A motion to accept my appointment. Have a motion from Speaker Pro Tem Jeff Phillips. Is there a second? A second.
Or Rhonda?
No.
Okay. Allen. Commissioner Phillips? I mean, Allen.
Okay. Any discussion? Questions? Seeing none. Oh, yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Can you tell me a little bit about, are you replacing somebody, or are these new positions in the committee?
They're replacements, I believe, aren't they? Yeah, both had stepped down.
Thank you.
Okay. I have a motion and a second before us. All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries. Thank you for accepting. I think at our last meeting, we were going to say farewell, but our former member got up and left before we could even say that. So that's probably why it wasn't brought to your attention.
Yes, he had another appointment. He had to get out.
Sure, absolutely. Okay, Mr. Priest, now we can have roll call, please.
Preble Acton. Rhonda Allen.
Here.
Dr. Anthony. Amber Brown.
Here.
Shay Crowell.
Here.
Holly Deering. Alan Farley.
Present.
Jeff Phillips.
Present.
Shantae Sherrill.
Present.
Eric Tutobini.
Chairman, it takes a
yes,
quorum.
Sorry, you're here as well.
We can now officially conduct our business. So first, the chairman will accept to approve the minutes from the August meeting. Is there a motion?
Chairman, I'll proceed with the minutes of the final reading of the agenda.
The motion has been made. Is there a second?
Yes.
And a second. Any discussion? Questions? Seeing none, all in favor of approval of the minutes, signify by saying aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Next, members, is our financials. I'll turn the microphone over to Mr. Elam, our Director of Insurance and Risk Management.
All right, in front of you, you have the financials for the month of August. If you look at the year to date, you can see that the revenue at $49,241,075 compared to the expenditures year to date at $47,708,229. If you move down to the fiscal period year to date, you can see there's a big difference in that, with the revenue being $3,469,596 compared to the expenditures being $13,087,540. What I'll remind you again is that the county schools pay their premiums on a 10-month basis, and they start in September. So you're not collecting benefits premiums from them on the month of July and August, and that's what reflects that. So next month, you'll see a big change in that number for the fiscal year. If you move on to your tracker report, the next page, what I will bring to your attention on the far right-hand side, when you're looking at the totals, revenue versus expenditures, you're at $1.5 million difference. And overall, the plan itself, you want to stay at 0.03% or above, and that's where we're running, is right in that range or above. So premiums will start catching up for the next 10 months to what we see in this deficit that you have. Any questions? All right, on the 264 report, again, you have a graph in front of you that says year-to-date paid claims. Month of July, you see that there's not any claims that were paid. Month of August, you see a spike. What happened was we changed our property and casualty company to Assured Partners. We have a different third-party administrator. In the month of July, I reported last month, but the month of July, things were kind of, instead of being concerned about paying a bill twice, they went in and made sure that the bills that they were paying had not already been paid by the previous third-party administrator. And then if you look in August, that's catching up. I can't say for sure, but in September, I would expect that number to also be larger than what it was of September of last year. If you flip over to the next page, that is reflected in the year-to-date. The box to the far left, and you see the year to date is $48,040.93 compared to year to date last year at $112,815. And again, you have to keep in mind there's 1 month in there that was not paid. So I would expect it would start picking up over the next months when you look at that box again. And just to give you an idea, the year-to-date, of that year-to-date, the workers' comp claims was $40,500 compared to OJI at $7,500. And again, I will mention, we have not had workers' comp for at least 10 years, and that's still those claims, that's still in there. Any questions?
That completes your financial?
Yes, sir.
Is there a motion to accept financials? Have a motion. Is there a second? And a second.
What's the first? Ms. Crowell?
Ms. Crowell.
Okay.
Any questions? Okay. All those in favor signify by saying aye. All opposed? Motion carries. Next, we have...
Can I insert something real quick?
Sure.
Since we've gotten a third-party administrator, the information we've got is coming in a different manner than what we had before. So what we're trying to do is get a report that gives you more information, a little more detailed, and, you know, it will hopefully, you know, when you take it home, look over it, it'll answer some questions. If you have any suggestions, or if any of you have a report that you like better that we can kind of take our numbers and put into it, we're more than happy to take a look at it and to make sure we've got in there what you want to see.
Okay. Next on your agenda, we have workers' comp OJI stats. Dan Good. Mr. Good, you're recognized.
Good afternoon. In the month of August, the county had 26 injuries requiring medical attention. From your report there, you can see the breakout. That brings the year-to-date total to 169 injuries requiring medical attention. That being from January the 1st to the present. Under OSHA, 121 of those are OSHA recordable. 54 were restricted claims, 25 lost time claims, and 42 all others. If you look at the next page of your report, we tried to compare this year to the two previous years. And while it does kind of have peaks and valleys and things like that, if you'll notice, we have 169 at this time this year, and we have the exact same number as we had this time last year, 169. As far as the incurred dollars, next page of your report, the incurred dollars as of the end of August for this year is 343 as compared to 342 last year. And then just kind of sum up where those injuries were. On the last page of your report, we've broken it down to tell you whether it was in the Board of Education, County General, or the Highway Department. You'll notice that the Board of Education had 22 claims. The County General has 4. That's not expected for the Board of Education because they are just coming back from summer break, just coming back in, the students and everybody's trying to get settled down. So that's usually what does happen in the month of August for the board. And you can refer that back to your claims. You can see how in the month of August we go from the lowest two periods of the year being June and July and go up in August. And you have to remember the Board of Education has about 6/7 of the county population as far as employees. Let's end my report.
Then your report.
Any questions?
Alan.
Question, if you don't mind, do I need to use the mic?
Yes, sir, but I'd...
A question, if you don't mind, and Dan, it's a question that you probably have heard recently. We had 4 accidents outside of the Board of Education. Do you conduct the accident investigations on those accidents, or does the department do them, or what? How's that handled?
When the accident is turned in, there's a requirement of 4 pages that's required as far as an accident report. You have the OJI claim report. This is just kind of a summary of what happened. It's also where the individual actually selects the panel of the physician if they feel they need to go see the physician. Then there's also a employee injury statement where the employee actually gets to tell their part of the story. And then there, the third page of it is the supervisor's report. And in the supervisor's report, the supervisor does an investigation according to that report, and they have to fill that out and say what recommendations they have to try and prevent these injuries from reoccurring. And then the last page is a witness statement. Now, unfortunately, we don't have everybody following everybody around, so a lot of times we don't have a witness to the injuries. But we do have the supervisor statement where they actually do address the injury and what they can do to prevent that. Then if there needs to be a follow-up on that, I can either contact the supervisor, the school, or I can even follow up with going out to the site.
There's always some corrective action taken to prevent the accident from happening again, or a similar accident from happening again. How's that communicated throughout the system?
Right now, we don't communicate injuries from one location to another location as far as saying, you know, this school had an injury and tell it to all the other schools. We work with each individual school. When we go around and do inspections and talk to them, I communicate to them some of the concerns. For example, one of the big issues we've had over the years past has always been during the summer months, the custodians waxing the floors and have a high rate of volume of waxing floors and slip, trips, and falls doing that. So every year, we communicate that just verbally to the schools and to the custodians as we talk to them and the summer comes up.
Not quite necessarily addressing the school system, but those other four accidents, are they communicated? What corrective action was taken so that other departments could also take some corrective measures to see, make sure that they're aware of any unsafe conditions that could be corrected? Are we communicating that to other departments or just handling it internally to that department?
Commissioner Phillips. I think in trying to address your question, it might be better for me instead of Dan to address the question. Right now, we're in the process of reviewing all of our procedures and how we're doing things. This is one of those that it's on the agenda to figure out we can better communicate ourselves and do exactly what you're talking about. In a few minutes, Chappa is about to come up here and to explain some of the changes that we've made and addressed in the benefits part. And I think with your HR background, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but we understand if you don't teach them, then the things keep happening over and again. If there was a wet place in the floor, and it came from rain, then you're gonna have a wet place in the floor again. Don't just mop it up. And if it hasn't rained, then someone dropped the water, you get it up, then you've corrected it. But to your point, every accident should have a correction of some sort. If it's an unsafe act or if it's an unsafe condition, you need to follow it up with education. You need to follow it up with somebody taking a look at it and saying, what did we do? Was it caused by somebody spilled water, or was it caused by a roof leaking? So with that being said, one of the things, and I just give you a perfect example, when I came in and I looked at our budget, and our budget said there's only $250 in there for gas for the entire department, first thing that told me is we're not getting out enough. I mean, that's just not a lot of money for 49 schools that we have now. That's not a lot of money to get out to the schools. So that was one of the first things, but in trying to stay within the budget. What we started cross training, and we started trying to put someone in Dan's position to handle more of the clerical stuff so Dan can get out and be at the schools more and work with the county schools more of a partner on trying to do exactly what you're saying. That being said, unfortunately, what happened was the person that we had doing the cross training did a great job and she was doing a lot of the clerical stuff. We were in that transition, left for a better opportunity. So now we're starting back over again. I know this is a long answer to your question, but now we've got to work again. We've got to get Dan out, what he does best. He's got 12 years of experience, and his knowledge, we've got to get it from our department to everybody else's department and be a partner with those supervisors like he's talking about in saying, have we addressed it and make sure there's not a gap, if that makes sense, there's something doesn't fall through the cracks. And I hope I've answered your question, but.
You have. Everything that you said makes a lot of sense. And let me just echo, since Dan has been, how long have you been here, Dan? 8 years? 12 years? Goodness gracious. 12 years. But before Dan, we really didn't have a program. We really didn't have a safety program. And since he's been here, he's taken us to a level. But one of the things I think we have to address, and I don't know how to do it, the school system seems to run their own show, but if we have 22 accidents every August, what are we doing to educate, especially the new employees that are coming on every August, what are we doing to educate those guys as to what types of a safety attitude we as a county have?
And what keeps reoccurring.
Exactly.
And let me add something to what you said. Just recently, I asked for a meeting with the county schools, sat down with Dr. Anthony and Doug Bodery and Jeff Sandvik and their team of people, trying to develop better dialogue, trying to develop better ways that we can work together with our interchanging of information that we have to be more efficient. This is something that's on the agenda to be more efficient with our accidents too, not only how we report them, but look at the ones that keep reoccurring and how they keep reoccurring. And without violating some HIPAA laws, because what I want to say is we have some things on the list, and you know, since I've been here, the county schools have been awesome for me to work with and have taken time out of their busy schedules also to address things with me. I would like to continue that effort, and I to answer your question, I think if you give just a little time, you'll see a great improvement with a partnership. I do.
I'm not going anywhere. You got all the time in the world as far as I'm concerned.
Well, I'm glad.
But my whole thought process is we've gone to a certain level, and as we continue to grow and grow and grow and grow, how are we educating new employees as they come aboard about our safety awareness program and safety attitudes? And I think that has to be part of whatever orientation we put any employee through, including school employees. And if we're not doing that, that's where I was going with this whole process. Yeah. We just need to make sure that we begin to take this thing to another level, because if we don't, we'll be sitting here talking about 22 accidents again next year.
Commissioner Phillips, you bring up a good point, and I think Ms. Stevenson in HR, she puts on, because I go and speak once a month to the new employee orientation, and Dan's right downstairs. I think it would be good if we could carve out some time for him to come up, and let's start setting, you know, that changing those dynamics and creating that atmosphere of being safety conscious with all of our new employees as they come in. Sonia?
One of the things that we've done is they created a video, and we do show that video in the orientation, but I always am an advocate for the personal touch. I'm an in-person kind of person. I like to see a face to say, who do I send that report to? So absolutely, he would be more than welcome to come up for an in-person presentation if he'd like.
I think that'd be good. Because it appears, Jeff, we seem to be doing the same thing every August, right?
Yeah. You know. And I know what Dan said, off in the summer, coming back, but it doesn't excuse any type of a neglect of a proper safety attitude. And I'm not going to say unsafe acts, okay, but maybe that's what they are. And it's just one of those things that we do probably when we're at home that we shouldn't be doing, but that carries over into the workplace. And as long as we're not having a safety type of an attitude about anything that we do, whether it's in the school system or with the road board or whatever, our accidents our total incident rate is not going to come down. And that should be our goal, is to bring that total incident rate down. And as a keeper of the county coffers, every dollar that we can save in this program goes directly back to the taxpayers of this county. Every dollar, every cost, every dollar that we spend comes out of the taxpayers' money, and every dollar we can save goes right to our bottom line. And that's the reason, to me, it's so important.
Indeed.
Yes, sir, Commissioner Phillips, and I agree with you. I was on the Budget Committee for 4 years and on the Health and Ed Committee for 4 years, so we're on the same team here, I promise you.
Mr. Farley.
A couple of things, and I know Mr. Phillips touched on one of them, is, of course, safety awareness. I mean, it's creating a culture, whether it's from risk management department through the whether it be Board of Education, whether it be whatever department. So it's really everybody kind of setting that culture. But two things, the August aspect is, what programming do we have in place to kind of come back and address, because you did mention that it reoccurs every August coming back. So if we kind of know that every August this seems to be our top three accidents, so having some programming in place to address that. But also, too, when you do the investigations or the reports, do you look at the time of service, whether is it fairly new employees with less than 2 or 3 years seem to be getting injured, or is it people who have, 10, 20-year length of service? I would say probably somebody who's closer to probably new to 2 or 3 year time of service, but is that something that's looked at as well?
As far as people are concerned, it's pretty much all over the board, unfortunately. There are new people every year that do have accidents and things like that, but there's also some of the ones that's been with the county for some period of time. I think a lot of it comes back to is when you're in the school system, you have a lot of the kids running around, and a lot of things are reflected in that the individual's attention is distracted by the student. Either the child's over here running around, I ran to keep this child from running out into the road, I tried to get this child back to the room, and that's when the injury occurs, because they're taken out of their organized environment of what handling the classroom and have to react to something, and then everything else kind of gets slipped around and things like that. So it's all over the board as far as that's concerned. But as far as programs, yes, we started not this year but last year, the Board of Education and the County General both, we sent out emails to the schools and everything saying that there's safety training that needs to be done during the first of the year. I've sent out mine this year. I know for a fact the school system sent them out last year, because I have talked to school board employees doing the training and calling and asking me about some of those questions. So I know that they're doing the training this year too. Unfortunately, when you have new people coming in the month of August with the Board of Education, they have a lot of training. New people. Mine is just a small part. You got a lot of federal training you have to do and state training they have to do. And so there's just a lot of training, and sometimes, yet, and they just hire in. They all basically start, if I'm not mistaken, the 1st of August. Am I not correct? So it's just a lot of training that's required by those individuals at the first of the year.
And I'm not picking on the Board of Education, because I mean, I know what you were describing. I was picturing my mind with teachers, and I wouldn't want to go 21 or 22 different directions, because I'm with that many kids in a classroom. Mm-hmm. You're literally going 21, 22 different directions. Thank goodness we have teachers willing to do that. But also, I mean, whether it be the road board, or whether it be anybody, whether it be, you know, the elections commission, or whether it be the planning department, you know, whether you've got 10 employees, whether you have, you know, 2,000 employees, a lot of times it's getting the attention, but it's just being forwarded in an email, but it's not really getting, the culture's not there to really expand upon the email, is what I was referring to.
Well, one of the things that Ed mentioned, and him and I have been discussing, is ways to better communicate. And that's one of the things that we're looking at right now, to see what we can do to better communicate safety to all county employees, not just the Board of Ed, not just the County General.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Ms. Allen, Commissioner?
I just have a few questions. Dan, on page 3, You said that the numbers for 2018 and 19 were really only, I'm almost identical, only $1,000 apart, but the chart and the pinpoint are off. Am I reading that incorrectly for August? With a little triangle, is on-job injury dollars occurred?
I'm so, sorry, on page 3, you're talking about the incurred dollars?
Right.
Okay.
Shouldn't the August chart for 2018 and your where your triangle is for 2019, shouldn't those be at the same point if they're the same amount of dollars?
Well, what that's doing is giving you a monthly projection of what those dollars are each month. So if you look at in the month of January in 2019, the dollars for that month was up there around $120,000, according to that chart, while the previous year, they were only down there somewhere around $10,000 that month.
Right.
So when you put it and add all that together, looking at that chart just the way you are, it's very difficult to understand where you are.
Okay.
So one of the meetings we had, I was asked, and I put out here to the side, the accumulation dollars to the end of that month. So if you were to look at January to the end of August, all those bars added together, that's what you got out there at the end.
Okay, I just want to make sure I was reading that correctly. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm.
Did I understand you to say on that 4-page report that's completed on every injury that one of the pages is a supervisor's investigation?
It's a supervisor's report, yes. Supervisors are asked to look at the accident and provide information about the accident and how credible the accident is. Whether it requires additional investigation, they recommend it to me. And then their recommendations for preventing that accident from reoccurring.
Do you give them any guidance on that or any training on that? Because I can just imagine, depending on my, you know, job as a supervisor, work comp or, you know, on-the-job injuries may not be something, I might not know exactly how to investigate something like that. So I'm just curious, do you ever provide any support or training to them or... Do they call you ahead of time before they do it, or how does that work?
There's probably an opportunity for better communication there. One of the things, though, is, it's, for example, if you're working in the kitchen, somebody in the kitchen has a lot better knowledge about what's going on in the kitchen than I personally would have. So that's where initially the supervisor has the biggest input, okay? And I rely upon the supervisor and what's going on for their area. That's why I review all that and then get back with them if there's recommendations for further follow-up on it too. But that's as Ed was saying, we have an opportunity we need to take and see if we can't work for better communications.
That's what I listened to. That's kind of what I heard,
yes.
Ed, that you were saying, is that we're working on all of that for risk management to be more actively involved,
yes,
in those investigations.
Yes. Because of Dan's 12 years of experience, it doesn't do the county, I think, as good of a service for him to sit in his office and do a lot of clerical work when he can get out. And like I said, $250 in your gas budget, I'm like, we're not getting out and going to the schools a whole lot for sure. So,
Dan, I have a couple of things. On this last page, when we used to get this report, we would also see it broken out by public safety and then also by dollars.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand.
You used to also break this out by public safety and then also dollars. It wasn't just county general as one. We would see the Board of Education, and then we might see what happened at the sheriff's office or highway or whatever. Can you, because here's the thing.
Part of that is, as Ed was saying, we're looking at trying to revise this report, and we're just exploring on how we can better present the information.
Well, that's one of the pieces I'd like to see is the public safety, because if you think about it, it's really shocking that in the jail and in the workhouse and on patrol, we don't have as many injuries as we do in the school system. So I'd just like to know specifically by public safety, you know, what is their experience? Because then also too, if they're doing something different in their training that we can learn from, then let's do that. But I'd just like to, if that's a piece that you can.
I think that will allow them to focus more on that department, you know.
Yeah, go where the problems are, right.
Yeah.
And then the last question that I had is, do we, when there's a third party who's responsible for an injury to one of our employees, do we ever pursue any kind of subrogation where we try to recover costs,
yeah,
from the responsible party?
Yes, yes. In all different aspects of it. I mean, if there was, if you have somebody maybe uninsured motorist, then and they caused the accident, yes, then they would subrogate to that person, try to get the money, just the same, you know, OGI, everything else, yes.
Sonia.
Back to Alan's point that he made about the training. One of the things that a prior employer we did, and this might be something that you look into, especially with the school system, and I may be wrong, but used to you would have a meeting with the principals at the beginning of a school year, and then also with your new hires for the school year. So maybe if you took your top one or two items that happen most frequently in August and covered so that they're not overwhelmed, because they do get a lot of data. Even if it's just a small post or something they can take back to kind of look at and educate their people, that maybe that's something you could do for the top number one or two that are the most cost occurring, like have the highest dollar cost to the county, that may be a way. And then like for us, if December, we knew that it was going to be snowing, so that's when we'd start, you know, talking about the things that we would do to prepare for snow, get your salt in, and maybe you could look at your claims in each month, what if there's something in common that's due to weather related or change in patterns with the schools or something that might help you. That's just something that we did at another employer that might help you guys.
Other questions? Mr. Good. Seeing none, thank you so much.
Thank you all very much.
Yes, sir. Have a motion to accept the report. Is there a second? And a second, Ms. Allen. All those in favor signify by saying aye. All opposed, motion carries. Next, we have the wellness update. Mr. Chuck Chapa. Mr. Chapa, you're recognized.
Hello, everyone. Before I start with the annual or the monthly report, kind of one of the things that we've been really focusing on this year as far as how can we better communicate, how can we get this information to the county. We had an incentive program change. We modified the Motivate Me system to include several things from like the preventative aspects, so including things like mammograms and the prostate exams, colon screenings, all the ones that are listed on here, but to better serve the members of Rutherford County. And so with that change, it was how do we communicate this? How do we reach on the ground the best that way that we can? And then talking with Ed a little bit as well of how can we not just communicate the Motivate Me and the incentive piece, but the benefit aspect as well. So how can we better communicate to the employees and get the correct information out to those employees this year? So that's something we've really been brainstorming and working towards for this year. So in conjunction with many of these events and things that we've been going out to as a department, we've had a benefits individual with us to help us to educate to those pieces. So how do your benefits work? How do those individual components things you need to know about open enrollment, everything like that. So in addition to this, when you see these numbers, these are all a symptom of us going out and being able to truly reach these. And so with that said, currently month to date or year to date, this is where we're sitting. So at annual physicals, we've got 1,597 complete. Biometric screenings, 3,018. For health assessments, we're sitting at 1,914. Mammograms, 917. OBGYN screenings, 1,533. Colon cancer screens, 323. Cervical cancer screens, 1,344. Prostate exam screens, 365. Flu shots are sitting at 1,700. And then one thing I wanted to do too, just in a comparison to this year versus last year, is look at our year-to-date numbers. So where were we sitting last year in comparison to where we're sitting now and in conjunction with what we've been doing? And so last year, and to keep in mind how the incentive program works, so September 30th will be the deadline. That's when that time period ends, the recording period will stop, and everyone needs to have their incentive pieces in by that time period. So traditionally, it's the next meeting where I'll report and I'll start showing more numbers as they trickle in through the system as people show. It takes a little bit of time for those to get into the Cigna system, so they won't reflect totally where we're at yet until we finish the incentive period. But that said, last year, we had the health assessment and the biometrics. We made that major change. So what I drew out based on where we're sitting today versus where we were in previous years. So the health assessment, 2018, last year, we were sitting at 465 completed. that's sitting in the Cigna system. 2019 year to date, we're at 3,018. Okay? For biometrics, last year we were at 1,596. This year we're sitting at 1,914. And then total year to date, so these are individuals that have completed their entire health assessment or their entire incentive pieces. So everything, they have met their incentive requirement, they will be earning that incentive. So last year at this time, it would have been 1,418, and currently year to date, we are at 3,531. And so you can see the percent increases on the right-hand side there. And so to combine with that, it's not simply our message that's getting out there, but in addition to that, and that's why the focus has been so hard on getting those messages out there from a benefits aspect too. So clearly our message is getting out, and we're getting the benefit aspect as well. So that's why we've been focusing so hard on certain areas and pulling that time away from certain individuals, okay? So that said, that is in conjunction with the Wellness on Wheels campaigns. We have been able to reach more people this year and interact with more employees this year, both with the Board of Ed and the County General components, than we have in all previous years. We've had an opportunity to really sit down and engage and have those great discussions and talk about the issues, and not just that, but process, improve, and modify the way we do things, and we're trying to learn and continue forward from here and modify and improve upon how we do things. So we're not going to try to stay put and just stay stagnant. We're continually to try to modify and improve at all times with that. But that said, you know, we were able to see countless people that we haven't in previous years, and we actually ran into Dr. Anthony at one of our last Board of Education Wellness on Wheels. So it was a good chance to see you there, and you can see us in action as well. So we went to every single county school, and we sat in every single break room or every single teacher's room, and I engaged with every county employee that I could round up and talk to as well. And so we've really had a successful run this year. And a shout out to Lee Smith too. She was there with me the entire time. So we have been on the clock, working really hard this year to get out there and improve with employees. And then we've been reaching out to Sheriff's Office and everything as well, and we continue to field that. But just again, it's about getting our message out there and being able to communicate it and continually evolve with things like the QR code that we created and get that out there. That's helping us to be able to communicate in new and interesting ways. And we're always trying to modify and improve from there. And so, you know, as we proceed into the future with other groups and other areas with the risk management and the benefits team, that's kind of where the focus is. So more to come, and it'll be improved upon that. Life Services EAP program, that'll be available on demand September 17th. It's on effective time management, and this time of year, we've really had to rely on that. So that's something that'll be available to all employees through the Life Services EAP. And then lastly, I'd like to talk about the Rutherford County Wellness Fair. So it's coming up October 18th. It's also conveniently the exact same time that open enrollment will start. October 18th at noon is when open enrollment will start. We'll be conducting on-site enrollment this year at the Wellness Fair. And so we have been communicating this quite effectively to all departments and groups that we have, and we appreciate all the communication we've gotten from leaders and everyone at the county as well. That said, we're going to try to do on-site enrollment. We'll have all the same fun vendors and things out there that we usually do. We'll also be doing a few smoothie bikes out there, so we'll be blending up some smoothies on smoothie bikes and a few other challenges and things like that, so it'll be a really good time. But with that said, one thing we kind of, Ed and I have been talking about a little bit, is this will be the first year of us offering on-site enrollment at the health fair. And so we have promoted it, and we have run it to every flagpole we can find. But we are kind of at a loss, for we don't know. So we may see a high volume, and we'll do the absolute best that we can to evolve. But the thing is that we've been doing so well at getting that message out there, and that's something that we really appreciate from all leadership involved and helping us with that. But again, this is more to come. We're evolving. We're trying to get better with that. But we do appreciate all the partnerships, especially Board of Education, Sheriff's Office, and all the other departments that have helped us to be able to get out there as well. But that is all I've got, I left something
out. Yeah, talking about our schools and each one of our departments, would it be possible if we just had a flyer printed up and we were able to get it out, you know, could we get a flyer printed up and maybe to put in each one of the schools' teachers' lodges or at each one of the departments?
In conjunction with us going out to every department and everything, if most of the schools will look on their fridge, I've stuck the wellness flyer up there, or the wellness fair flyer, so it's out there, sir.
Okay.
We've gotten that message, and I appreciate everyone sending it. And I'll send them one more email blast with the QR code and the wellness fair flyer on that as well. And so we can definitely communicate that as far as we can go.
I do believe that the health department's going to be there. We're going to have blood pressure testing booth and
flu shot clinics.
Flu shots. Get your flu shots. What about mammograms?
Mammogram bus will be out there. I'll start sending the mammogram scheduler. I'm waiting on St. Thomas to be able to get out there and just give me the scheduler. So more to come. Definitely keep your eyes out for the emails coming out. But it should be a really great opportunity for members to come out and employees to come out. Get a few Cigna points for next year, and then also do your on-site enrollment and talk to those Cigna teams and the benefit teams and go through. And if you want to really sit down with an individual and go through your benefits, that will be an excellent opportunity.
I want to say thank you for doing that, because so many times you're sitting at home trying to pull it up and talking to your spouse, you know, what is best, what should we do this year, what kind of deductible do we want to do, et cetera. So if you can actually come in and talk to someone at the health fair and get enrolled, I think that'll be huge for our employees. So thank you for our department and Cigna for thank you. And I'm sure you'll have plenty of Cigna swag or some sort that you can
we'll bring it all.
Hand out, right?
Mayor Ketron,
yes, sir.
The biggest thing that we have tried to do is the same thing that Commissioner Phillips is saying, is get out there before you get to the annual enrollment and educate everybody you can. So when you got to the annual enrollment, most of the questions are not about, I can't decide what plan to pick, but it's, I need help getting through the annual enrollment. What can you do for me? And they've done an excellent job. One of the other things that we've kind of looked at is to let everybody know, on your beneficiaries, the beneficiaries that you have picked, we've said several times to people, just making them aware, you can go in there and change that year round. But when you sit there and you talk to somebody and they're going, oh, I haven't checked mine in 10 years or so. And then all of a sudden they look and says, well, that's my ex-spouse. I need to change that. Can you change that right now for me? So that has happened a lot this year. But it's just exactly the program I think you're talking about with the safety is getting that, get as much education as we can out there. And I will say they've done an excellent job to get to every school and every department and to organize it. I think they've done a great job. And I want to give a kudos to the county schools, because they have been awesome coordinating things with us and letting us in and giving us the opportunity to speak to the employees.
Any questions?
I just have one suggestion, Mr. Chairman. I'm thinking about those employees of ours who, particularly public safety, who will be working during this time, who wouldn't have an opportunity to come. Are their spouses able to come do open enrollment, or does it have to be the employee? If they were going to come do their enrollment while this is going on, where they could have a live person there talking to them, could a spouse come do that, or does it have to be the employee?
Actually enroll, it'll have to be the employee, but what we can do and what we're doing as a caveat to it is, so if we do hit a volume that we just cannot sit with everyone, we're going to schedule out appointments. And the fortunate thing is that it's October 18th, the first day, so we've still got 2 weeks to help and to answer questions and things like that. So if we identified individuals that even need a follow-on, they need to come into risk management, sit down and discuss the things, we have the resources to be able to help them as well. So if the spouse wanted to come out and kind of information gather and then wanted to come in and actually be able to enroll, we could accommodate that as well.
If the employee will call the office and make arrangements and let us know, but we cannot just change somebody's plan, a spouse or a dependent or somebody like that. There'd be people changing beneficiaries all the time.
I'm just trying to think outside the box for those folks who will not be able to meet, be there at that time frame. And what you're doing, so many things right, and I think it's fantastic, and I want to give you major kudos for that. Those numbers are beyond impressive. I mean, it's really something. Y'all have done a really good job with that, so congratulations on that. So maybe you even pitch that to the public safety folks as an information opportunity and then the employee can go back, because I completely understand that, but I was just trying, like I said, I'm trying to think about those folks who just, there's no way they're going to make that time frame. They're going to be on the job during that particular window of time.
Well, if they will call our office ahead of time, make those arrangements, give that permission, then we can do it.
Well, I would say, you know, even if you don't want to do the permission, if you just want to say, make sure your spouse comes, make sure they come get the information, because if it's the way it is at my house, you know,
there's careful, more, careful.
One of us goes and collects all the information and shares it, and then together you make a decision. So it might be that person who, you know, could come get the information, and then, like you said, when they get home, go share it.
Well, if I don't want to get into this too much, but what we have set up is we have different layers, and we'll have someone that will greet you when you come in, ask you your questions, so it doesn't bog down the people that are ready to go online. So if it all works out right, and I hope it does, but we've got someone that will kind of push you in one direction or the other. Okay, you've got questions and you need to go over here, and here's Cigna you need to talk to, or WageWorks, you know, for your FSA or something like that. And that doesn't bog down the people who want to sit down at an all-in-one and enroll at that point. So we're hoping we can take care of a lot of things, answer a lot of questions that somebody might have, and you may go home and say, I'm not ready to make that decision. And at that point, then we make a phone appointment, or we make an appointment in the office in that 2 weeks, so that person, you know, you can come back and we can address it for you when you're ready. But just remember, November 1 at 12 o'clock is the deadline. And just so everybody understands, the reason why we did it on Friday at 12 o'clock is that it gives the employees 2 weekends to study it. Then if you have a question, you've got 4.5 days to call us about your questions after you've had your 2 weekends, instead of doing it cut off on Monday and someone, you know, got sick or whatever happened. So that's why we've moved it to Friday and Friday for the annual enrollment.
Sonia.
One of the things that they might could do, to your point, is create maybe a one-page cheat sheet, for example, like have health insurance, medical, dental, and if the spouse does come and sit down just to ask the questions, they could write in the plans they want and take it back to their spouse to input it. Does that make sense? So then you've kind of gone through all the options and said, what is the best option for my family? And it would just be a one-pager that they could just fill in the information as they go. It's just a thought to try to, for those people who couldn't come, if their spouse could be there.
Yeah, well, to push this just a little bit further, the booklets will go out, should be going out in the next 48 hours, I think, 48 to 72 hours. We also will have it online where someone can go online and see the book itself. So, you know, as we're trying to get this out there, is now's the time, if you have any questions when you get ready for annual enrollment, look at your questions now. Nothing's going to change now that you can't make the decision, you know, before you get there. And, you know, the QR code's going to push you to it. Website's going to push you to it. So
that's part of it, is just being able to have more access as well. So we've increased that piece too. But this one's going to be a learning experience for us. It'll kind of lay out some the way things will work, and we'll kind of process and improve from there. But we're going to do everything that we can in order to address you know, employee need and make sure, even for those individuals, because that is something, a very good point for those individuals. But we'll definitely try to accommodate as much as we can.
Anything else?
That's all.
Sure.
No, sir.
If we could, well, let me just preface this by saying this whole process starts with the mayor. I think the buck stops there, but it's through Ed, it's through you that I just see excitement that I've never really seen before. If we could just get somebody excited about garbage.
We're working on that too. Just hang on.
We're finding them.
Wellness, maybe we could move off of ground zero and head in that direction. But
Commissioner Phillips, does that mean you'll be there for cleanup after the wellness fair?
Sure. Yeah.
I could use the help.
the numbers that you present, like annual physicals,
yes, sir.
That's impressive. But what would be more impressive to me, if you could put that in percentages, it would be more meaningful to me. 1,600 sounds pretty impressive. But if it were 50% or 60% or something, gotcha. It would be a little bit more clear to me if you could maybe put percentages on that, and I know it might be a little tricky with mammograms and things like that, but if there's a way to maybe just take that to the next step and say 1600, which represents blank percentage of eligible the population, it would be more meaningful to me.
Definitely. One thing I do put on there just as a point of reference, so every time before I come to this meeting, I try to get the most recent eligible employees that can take part in this incentive. And so there are some, you know, your part-time and other individuals that don't qualify. But if you look down there at the asterisk where it's the 6,479, I can break it out a little bit further, but that is the out of the total. So 6,479 at the very bottom there, that's the current amount of eligibles as of 9/25 that we have that's able to complete this. And so I'll need to do a little bit of math, but I can backwards calculate off of where we're sitting, off of that number.
Spot, but while you're up there, maybe Ed can share this spot. We talked a little bit about diabetes prevention program last month. We're going to be talking about it again this month. In your opinion, is that a form of wellness?
Yes, sir. I mean, you're looking at whole body in regards to that, but that's one thing too, and I know it was brought up earlier, it's a culture concept, and you're talking about a culture of safety, you know, and this here is clear indication that we're building a culture of not just wellness, but health. So the reasoning behind this is something to look at these numbers. I know it's just numbers on a page, but when you look at, so take your mammograms, for instance, 917. That's 917 individuals that we could early detect, and we could have saved a life in regards to that, being out that. So when you look at these things, it's not just, and that's something to convey to everyone as well, it's not just go out there and get the incentive. The reason, the purpose behind this is to delve into that preventative aspect. It's really going to be, we are trying to not only establish a good sense of health, but to catch and prevent certain conditions that could be changed. So if we catch someone that's early diabetic, we can change, or we can help that person with that lifestyle and help them achieve something, or early detection of cancers or other conditions like that too. So it's really important when we really kind of pull back from why we do this. Yeah. I support it, yes, sir.
Other questions?
I almost didn't ask this, but since you led me right into it, Jeff, so I'm going to ask it anyway. On the mammograms and on the colon screenings and things like that, it would be interesting if you can drill down, which I imagine Cigna probably can. There's a certain number of that 6,479 that you want to reach 100% of mammograms. You don't need 6,000 people, obviously, to go get mammograms.
We would not.
Right. Yeah. And you've got people over 50, maybe, who need a colon screening, and then some who've had a colon screening and don't need another one for 10 years. So it'd be interesting to me to know, on those kinds of internal benchmarks and thresholds, where are we hitting on those? So, because even though it might not be 100%, it might be 80% of the number we really needed to get to in specific areas.
Other questions for Mr. Chapman? Seeing none. Thank you very much.
Thank you very
Appreciate
much.
Your report. And he's already covered our wellness fair also on item number 7, but we'll go back to number 6, the Cigna. Did you know we actually started this last month, and it's just a brief synopsis just to inform, just to educate our folks on this committee. And so Lee Smith has got some did you know facts.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Cigna Did You Know? So you guys segued very nicely into what I have to talk about today. This is a tool that Cigna has created just for Rutherford County this year as an open enrollment tool, medical plan selector, if you will. And we had one similar last year, but it wasn't really intuitive. It just kind of laid out the plan side by side, and you kind of had to figure it out as you go. On this one, if you flip to the inside cover, in the little orange box, it shows you a website to go to, and it has a code. If you're a Board of Ed, there's a code. If you're County General, there's a code. And that's just based on the fact that you guys have different pay cycles, and it's going to show your monthly premiums based on that. So once you go in there, it's going to ask you some questions. What is your zip code? Who are you covering? Is it just you, or is it you and your family, or you just you and a spouse? And then it's going to ask you if you have any upcoming medical expenses planned. Are you having a baby? Do you anticipate having surgery? And then how important is it to you that your providers are in network? On the other side, you see a little cheat sheet where you can actually fill this out and bring it to the wellness fair or to us at the insurance department. And you can fill it out, and we can help you through the process, because I know some people don't have access to a computer. But once you enter all that information, it's going to generate the best plan for you and your family based on your answers, and it's going to show you the monthly premium. It's also going to show you the second option plan available to you and the premiums at the top, and that gives you the opportunity to go line by line through your coverage to look at how it's going to pay for your doctor visit, for your specialist, how much is this going to pay for the medication that I take, how much is this going to pay if I have to go to the emergency room. So it's a really good interactive tool, and we have gotten it out to as many departments as we possibly can. We're still in the process of getting it out to some of you. But we've definitely gotten it in the schools and most of the bigger county general departments. But if you guys need these, want these for your department, if you'll reach out to me, I'll be happy to send them through interoffice mail, or I can bring them to you. It's also, I was going to tell you, in the open enrollment books that will be mailed out soon, the information on how to log on to the system is also in that book. So employees have several ways to access it. So does anybody have any questions for me?
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you, Ms. Smith. Okay, down to item number 8, open enrollment. We covered that?
Yep, I think we've pretty much covered it. Unless someone has any questions about it. Again, October the 18th to November the 1st, Friday to Friday.
Okay. Item number 9, MedPoint report. Ms. McNair. Hi.
Good afternoon. If you'll open our MedPoint report, we're going to be discussing our August numbers. On the first, or slide 2 there, you're going to see this month in at MedPoint regarding our August 2019 total clinic visits there at the top. We saw 1,238 total clinic visits. Out of that, we saw 784 provider visits, 36 medical assistant visits that would include like labs, injections, things like that. 364 biometric only visits, and I want to reiterate, this doesn't mean we only did 364 biometrics. That means that those are the ones that came in only for that reason. So if they came in and saw a provider, they would be counted under the provider visits, and they also got a biometric, but we wouldn't count them twice. So the 364 is just those that only got the biometric screening and did not see anyone else in the clinic for any other reason. We had 9 occupational health visits and 45 wellness visits with our registered dietitian and wellness coordinator. And I would like to mention that our wellness coordinator and registered dietitian did try to attend most of the Wellness on Wheels with the Cigna team when they were able to promote the different services that we offer there and answer any questions about what we can do to help get them their incentive points for this year. Below that, we had the non-face-to-face encounters. The first one is the orders only. So that would be if a patient needed a medication refill, sent to a pharmacy, if we got a lab result back and we needed to change a medication, if we got a chest x-ray and now they needed a CT scan, was warranted based on the results of that. And we wouldn't bring the patient back in necessarily for that unless we needed to consult them for different reasons, but we may put that in as an order only. So that's 139. Communication encounter, that would include if we called the patient or the patient called us to ask questions about their results, or if we sent them a message through our patient portal. We had 273 of those for August. And results review with letter communication was at 605. And we generally see that increase related to the biometric screenings that we do in the office, because everyone that we do gets a results review letter either sent out through the patient portal or mailed to their home. So they let them know if they're normal or abnormal, and they get that communication. On the next page there, what's ahead? Flu shots are already available in our clinics. We started back on September 7th. They're currently available by appointment only at Walter Hill and Blackman, and by walk-in at Stewart's Creek or by appointment at that location as well. As the Cigna team has mentioned, we've got the health fair on October 18th. We will be administering flu shots at that event, as well as we'll have our MedPoint booth that'll be ran by our wellness coordinator and registered dietitian. Then at the bottom there, you see our walk-in flu clinics will be scheduled for the 2 weeks after the health fair, so October 21st through the 25th and October 28th through November 1st at our Blackman and Stewart's Creek clinics. Those times will be walk-ins between 7 a.m. and 11 a.m. and again from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. at those two locations. And then at Walter Hill, we're open from October 22nd and October 29th from 7 to 1 and 2 to 5 for walk-ins. Again, as I said before, they can make those appointments as well if they'd rather do an appointment, but those will be open for walk-ins those 2 weeks. For the anyone who has a is on the medical plan, ages 3 and up, so they have to be on the insurance plan, yes, sir. Dependents included ages 3 and up. And we do not have the enteral nasal spray. I know some people are asking about that. That's the live vaccine. We do not carry that. We only have the injections at the site. Any other questions? There's no out-of-pocket cost, no copay out-of-pocket cost at the time of service. Yes, sir. Okay, on the next slide, did you know MedPoint is accredited as a patient-centered medical home? And I'll go into what that is a little bit more on the next slide, but here what I wanted to kind of emphasize is that we are accredited by the HHC, which is the Accreditation Association for Ambulatory Health Centers, as a patient-centered medical home. That means we can be the primary care provider. The MedPoint providers can be the primary care providers for members, dependents that are on the insurance plan. We treat acute and chronic conditions being the hypertension, diabetes, hyperlipidemia, those things. And then we have relationships in the community for referral management when medically appropriate. So say you're a diabetic and you need to see an endocrinologist. We already have those relationships out in the community with these different specialists to be able to refer to these providers when it's medically appropriate. And then last thing here, just like to point out that we have continuity of care with board certified providers who you know and they know you. So you're not seeing, you don't have to see a different provider. You can follow that same provider and they get to know you and build that rapport. They know your medical history and develop that relationship with you. We do have appointments with the medical doctors and the nurse practitioners available. So the next line is just kind of how you would establish care with us today. So you can call our clinics at the number listed there to schedule an appointment. You can schedule through the patient portal or go to rcmedpoint.com. It will redirect to the patient portal, or they can email us at medpoint@premishealth.com and just let us know that you want to establish care. Typically, we try to get medical records from your previous provider just so we can see about your history, but we can also get that when you come in, but we can establish care with you at that time. Any questions? Yes, ma'am.
How stable is your staffing at these clinics? Because that's a big thing in establishing a relationship with a primary care provider, is you don't want there to be a lot of turnover. So.
Right. So I'm trying to think. Two of the providers, the nurse practitioners that we have, y'all may know them, Carla Adams, Angela Rushing, they have been there, I think, since 2011 when we took over the contract with Rutherford County. So they have been there for, 8 years now. Our medical director has been there for 6 years. This last May. So yes, it is. I mean, when you develop that relationship, you'd like to stick with them. And so we do have a lot of providers that have been there for years. Thanks.
Other questions? Seeing none. Thank you.
Oh, still going. Almost done.
Okay.
Sorry.
Keep going.
So on the next slide there, it talks a little bit more about that HHC accreditation that I was talking about as a medical home. So the Accreditation Association for Ambulatory Healthcare advocates for the provision of high quality healthcare through the development and adoption of nationally recognized standards. The HHC certificate of accreditation demonstrates an organization's commitment to provide safe, high quality service to its patients. So they say, think of HHC medical home accreditation as the highest achievement for primary care. It centers on a comprehensive review of our entire organization. So When they came in and did that survey for us this year and we received that accreditation, they went to all three clinics, even though we're considered one MedPoint. They went to all three of our clinics and did a comprehensive review of each site to make sure, and then we were accredited as a patient center medical home at all three different sites. It's a symbol of prestige that we can truly be proud of, a mark of excellence honoring the fact that we adopt best practices and comply with these nationally recognized standards of care. For your employees, it provides comforting reassurance that we'll receive high quality care when they need it. And then the last couple slides, just kind of as an appendix, some showing some trends and some graphs there. I did want to mention in July, there was a clerical error that has now been updated on this spreadsheet for the clinic visits, and it was 1,391. It was correct in last month's report on the first or the second page, but there was a typo on this slide that has now been updated. But it just shows the bar graph there where we saw 1,238 clinic visits and then non-face-to-face encounters at 1,017 for August. The next slide is the summary that shows our August 2019 total operating costs at $214,197 with a total unique member count of 1,099. And remember, that means that 1,099 members saw the clinic, came to the clinic at least one time. They may have come more, but they came at least once out of that 1,099. Then the last slide just goes over our incoming calls. In August, we had 2,010 incoming calls to the MedPoint clinic, which gave us an incoming call average per day of 91. And that concludes my report.
That concludes your report. Any questions for Ms. McNair?
Allen? You usually give us a per member per month rating on cost. Is that something you've dropped from their report? Or?
Yeah, we haven't done that in the last couple of months for the per member per year because not every member who you guys have utilizes the clinic. So that was removed. I'm trying to remember what month that was removed. It was removed before the summer. But if Mr. Elam, if you guys think it's important and you're okay with it, Mr. Elam, we can definitely add that back in to this report.
Yeah, I think I'd be happy to see it maybe even on like a quarterly trend or just something so that we know, because part of what you're trying to gauge is what's, you know, offering this service provides us real cost savings elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to lose sight of that. So,
okay.
Yeah, I think even quarterly would be good.
Okay.
Other questions? Seeing none, thank you so much. Yes, ma'am. Next members, we have Omada Paul Huffman. Mr. Huffman. You're recognized, Mr. Huffman. Yes, sir.
Good afternoon. I'm Paul Huffman with Cigna Healthcare. And if you recall, those of you who were here last month, we introduced to you a company called Omada, a company that Cigna has partnered with to deliver a pre-diabetes prevention program, one that they are leading the industry in. We presented this program as an optional program if Rutherford County wanted to install that for their employees, and we gave you some information on that program last month and went through some details on that. Following that meeting, I was tasked with bringing back two pieces of information from the motion to kind of give Ms. Hickerson and some others, more of a real feel of the program and maybe an example. There were two things. You wanted an example of how the cost works, and number two, what is in place currently that's being offered to individuals who might be pre-diabetic, who may not have a smartphone or a technology to access this coaching program via a smart technology. So one thing I'll start with, and I put this on your table, it's just a small presentation. And before we get started, we'll look at that first page. I'll bring you back to a baseline of what we said when we started. About 84 million people in America are considered pre-diabetic. That's about one in three of every American. 9 out of 10 of those are not even aware that they have that risk. Okay? 15 to 30% of those are going to end up with type 2 diabetes at some time in their lifetime. And once they do, they're going to incur, on average, and this number can be debated a little bit, anywhere from $10,000 to $15,000 in claims. And that's comorbid claims, claims that are associated with their diabetes, things that are related to that with heart conditions, stress, things of that nature. So we know it's a very expensive disease, and we know that there is a large population at risk for it. So Cigna went out and developed a relationship with this company, Omada, to deliver a digital coaching experience for those who are eligible and who qualify as having a pre-diabetic condition. If you look at this first page, so for the example in cost, and I'll get right to the details because I know I don't want to go into everything that we talked about last month, but if an individual is eligible, they enroll in the plan, it is zero cost to them. It's a preventive care visit. It's 100% coverage under the medical plan, and the plan, the county, would pay $235 right off the bat through a medical claim. So Omada is going to send us a medical claim. We will reimburse them just like any other medical doctor would send to us if you accessed a preventive care visit. $235 would be charged for that one person. That person will receive a digital scale mailed to their home, and it's automatically hooked up to a cell phone, and it will measure their weight every day and send their weight to Omada. The first day they step on it will set their baseline. And every month after that, when they weigh themselves, Omada is going to tell us if they have lost 1% of their weight or not. And each month, if they have reduced their weight by 1%, Omada is going to tell us, Cigna is going to reimburse them $13 and charge the county $13 just as another medical claim. So in other words, we are paying for performance. You are paying for performance. If you look at the second year, people can stay in the program for 2 years, and as they lose 1% of body weight in the second year, the cost goes down to only $8 per 1% of body weight loss. If you turn
to the
next
page.
Days
in there?
Yes, sir, I'm sorry?
You have any free days in there like Thanksgiving or Christmas?
Of course. Scales don't work on those days. So the next page. Looks like this, the average cost per participant. We anticipate on average, based on the numbers that we have seen of those who enroll and the amount of weight that they typically lose, in the first year, that $235 plus the 13 on top of 13 and whatever, averages about $530 a year on average per person. In the second year, the amount that they're losing, that $8 per 1%, averages about $150 per person. The return on investment that we saw from our pilot studies and from the CDC that has commissioned this program, make it an average. We'll call it a two to one ROI. It's anywhere from 1.5 to 2. But think about it this way. Every dollar that is spent on someone losing weight, you're going to get $2 back in return from savings in a prevention of getting them to that diabetic level, okay? If you turn to the next page, this is the actual savings. So we're going to save you, like I said, anywhere from 1.5 to 2.1 to $1. And over here, you're going to see that your savings per person after the costs have been removed are going to be anywhere from $400, $424 to $972 per person. Okay. The next page, Omada tells us that based on the 6,500 eligible population that we heard about a minute ago, that if we do a full campaign, if Rutherford County wants to add this program, they put it in place, we do communication, we get emails out, we talk about it, there's a good chance we could get close to 412 people enrolled. I think that's a little aggressive. I'll tell you, we have this program in place with the state of Tennessee. They elected to add Omada. And I think Ed and I were talking, they've probably only got maybe 800 participants is what we've heard. I can double check that and fact check that later. So you can see that percentage-wise is not very high. Metro Nashville Public Schools, another one of my accounts that I worked on, added this program at the beginning of 2019, and they have over 300 individuals that signed up right off the bat. And they're close to your size when you look at the population. I think they had close to 10,000 eligible. So 400 might be a little aggressive. We might say you get 200 to 300 people enroll. So think of that multiplied by that amount that we're considering saving you over a two-year period. And we would estimate that after you've spent the money, after those claims have been paid by Cigna and the people have lost their weight, you're probably going to end up on the good guy side of about $175,000 over 2 years. So that's the answer to the first question. The second question goes to a page like this. I won't read it all, but I will tell you that for those individuals who either are not eligible, who don't have a smartphone, who can't handle the ability to receive the coaching digitally, Cigna already has in place. This is in place today. It's called Your Health First for Weight Management. It is a lifestyle management program that is available to everyone in the county that's on the medical plan to help them reduce their weight. All they have to do is call the number on the back of their card, ask to speak to a coach regarding the lifestyle management program for weight, and this is what they get. I'll just highlight, if they enroll in the program, they will receive a one-on-one coach who will schedule calls with them, set goals with them, talk about the things that are challenges to them and their eating habits, exercise habits. We will ship them a portion plate to help them get an idea of how their portion sizes should look, tape measure to keep track of their waist size, a workbook to go through some programs, and that is already in place. So we would recommend that for individuals who want to get help but don't have the digital capabilities. And then lastly, this question, so that answers Ms. Hickerson's two questions, I hope. The last few pages address a question that Ms. Miller asked me last month, and that is, could the county create an incentive award for participation in OMATA? And the answer is yes. And this is what those goals would be. So on this page, if the county wanted to at some point, and I'm not recommending that you do it this year or whenever, I'm just letting you know that it is an availability to add to the incentive points to put in a participation goal in the OMATA program. If they wanted to have a point associated with it or something like that, you could do that. Those are an example of two of the goals that can be selected, okay? And then one other concern that Ms. Hickerson had was that, you know, if this program is in place and someone has it and they get a point for it, but her guys can't use this program. They can use Your Health First or whatever. Cigna always offers for all of our incentive points what's considered an activity-based, a recommended alternative waiver form. And I gave you a copy of this form in the back. So individuals who can't complete some of these wellness incentives, if this was one of them, always have the ability to print this form from MyCigna.com, take it to their physician, talk to their physician about a program that is equivalent, if you will, to something of that nature, sign the form. The doctor will then identify that the member has completed it. This form is sent into Cigna, and that individual would get credit for a point for any program. So I wanted to make you aware of that there are alternatives in place for people who don't have the ability to complete those incentive points, such as OMATA, if it was one elected. Okay. That's all I brought today. I wanted to see if there's any questions that you had. Again, it's an optional program that Rutherford County can elect to put in at any time. If you do, we will work with your staff to communicate it well, and we will get OMATA engaged. They'll do all the heavy lifting, and basically it's just there to help those who need it.
Alan?
Well, thanks for bringing some more and additional information. I mean, I was advocating for this last month, and the more I thought about it and looked into this and read this, I mean, this is offering a program for folks, in most cases, that's self-inflicted. I mean, type 2 diabetes, because a lot of it's lack of knowledge. They just don't know what they need to do or how to do it. And I think this is giving that the resource. I mean, they want help. They just don't know how to go about accomplishing it.
Correct.
And I think this is something that's worthwhile. And you look at the money on the front end, yeah, there is an investment, but just like anything else, you've got a dramatic savings in claim cost. But if you don't do it, you're going to have greater cost. And then also, too, the increased productivity on the job, and that's one thing that we've got to look at. And then really the longer time of service, you know, they're not out of work for whatever reason. So I just think those gains by doing this offset what minimal cost it is to do this program. So I make a motion we adopt this.
Got a motion and a second. Discussion.
Is that Commissioner Phillips on the second?
That was Commissioner Phillips on the second. The motion would be from Mr. Farley to send it to forward it on from this committee as a recommendation to the steering committee with a favorable recommendation. And you second that, Commissioner Phillips. Any discussion? Commissioner Allen, Chairman.
Can you walk me through the numbers again? I'm just trying to follow the math. I'm trying to figure out the cost, because the immediate cost is going to be the $235 for whoever signs up. They get digital scales. They fall off the wagon. I still have high claims, and I just paid out $235.
Correct.
So I'm just trying to figure out how you're. I want to follow the math. So
that's built in. So any of the cost would be built into what we've seen on average as a whole, based on our results. And obviously, there's going to be people that fail at the program, but those costs are going to be included in that and annualized into that average. So
you've got here 412 is the estimated, but you don't think that's a real number.
I think it's a little aggressive based on our results on the state of Tennessee and Metro Nashville Public Schools. So I do think it'll be a little less than that. But according to AMADA, that's what they anticipate if they're given the tools and the email addresses and the ability to communicate and reach out. And so,
what do you think the number will be?
300.
And is that the number that will be presented to steering?
I mean,
that's a guesstimate, right?
A guess, yeah.
I just want to make sure that we've got accurate information, you know, because again, if 412 is best case scenario, I just want to know what kind of numbers are we really talking about.
If I have to put it in writing, which I did, I would say 412, but if you want my opinion, I think it's going to be a little less.
And then the $175,000 net savings. So, were you on the 175 net savings? Were you thinking that was on 300 or on 412?
400.
Mm-hmm. So that's saving on the low end then of your average savings. That's 424 per person. But I've already spent 235.
That's already taken out.
So that's already taken out. Okay. Trying to figure out. Thank you.
Are you okay with the motion as is, or do you want to make an amendment to the motion?
No, I'm sure if he'll be there to present to steering, they can have the same conversation, ask the same questions.
Okay.
I'm fine with it as it is. Thank you.
That is correct. Okay. Eric?
You said
I'm only making that based on why is it not the total of everyone? All the above. Yeah, it really would be. I mean, it's going to be across the board. Yeah. How do you get anything to be 100%? We work with the wellness on how do we get 100% mammogram screenings every year, and we don't. We get to 50% and we think we're doing great. You know, what's the reason for the rest? I don't know. It's all the above. Yeah.
Other questions? So, Chairman, I guess we could say that instead of falling off the wagon, they fall off the scales in this case, right?
Mm-hmm. Do they have, so like on the $13 that they get back for that 1%, is that immediately, or do they have to be on the program for so long and then they get that over the course of multiple months, or how does that
every,
work?
It's measured every month, so they're going to get that immediately. It's claim-based, so as soon as it's identified from OMATA that someone's lost 1%, then they're going to charge us $13. We put that through and pay them back and put that through your bank account. So, and then if somebody quits the program right then it just stops.
Is it only a two-year program, or can they be on it indefinitely?
No, it's only a two-year program.
Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, only question I have is how long does it take to launch the program? So once, let's say that green light goes on, how long will it take to be full scale?
Yeah, good question. Depends on what else you've got going on. We will engage OMATA immediately, and we'll probably have weekly conference calls with the benefits department, and I would say less than 30 days to have it set up and ready to know what they're going to be doing.
Other questions? Yes, sir.
You say it's a two-year program, but so is this designed to they create that culture, that change in lifestyle, so then it becomes automatic, but you're only paying for a
that's
two-year
correct.
Period?
Yeah, and that's the hope, is that we're going to give the program is designed to teach them the tools that they need to work through that, to manage their health, to start to lose weight, in hopes that when they finish that two-year program or those several weeks of programs and plans, that they have some of those tools to continue on. Absolutely.
Of course, one of those things, once you start having success, it kind of motivates you to continue going. But then there's going to be some. I mean, I ride a bike, and I know that riding 20 miles a day really helps. But there's just some days I don't want to go do it.
Yeah.
But you just have to, but I know that when I get those consecutive days in a row, I see the results and I get motivated. So that's what kind of
the key is to empower them to learn. Yeah, exactly.
Chairman.
Okay, so I just had one last question again, make sure I'm following the math. So $235 to get started, and then they can earn, let's say, best case scenario, they're losing 1% every month for the first 12 months. They're going to get $156, so that's 13 times 12. And then year two, they're going to possibly get 8 times 12. This is if they've just maxed out the whole thing. So
that wouldn't be a max out. So they could max out they could lose 5% in 1 month. So that's 5 times 13 in that month.
Okay, so they're not getting only
so
that.
Your max is unlimited.
I got you. Okay. So. That was what I'm trying to figure out is on that other end is are we only earning, are we only rewarding the 1%, but you're rewarding every
1%. Each
1%. Very good. Thank you.
Okay, other questions?
Question.
The motion before you is to send the motion of acceptance of this program to the steering committee with a favorable recommendation. It's been seconded. No further questions. All in favor signify by saying aye. All opposed, motion carries. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I happen to know I do have a conflict Monday night on the 7th, but we'll have somebody there.
That's a real good question. From an informational, we could have a booth for information, say it's got one more step to go through, for the full commission. It's close. So what do you think, Paul? Could you be fair to go on the 18th?
I think it's fair, yeah. And we can have we have brochures already developed for that, so we can have that at our booth for individuals that come through, and we can immediately talk to them about that. That can be one of the triage questions. You know.
Be a great opportunity to kick it off.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, the good thing to know is that this program's an additional program that you could add on to help people who are ready, who have the ability to do this, that fits their lifestyle, that works for them. But you also have the programs I mentioned before, which is a lifestyle management program for weight, and you also have disease management programs. So these are coaching programs that are in place that can be combined with this. It's a matter of we need to get that individual in touch with that coach, because that's who's going to identify that this person has a couple issues that need to be addressed, and that coach is going to be coaching them on a holistic basis on across all their medical conditions. And you know, we talk about this a lot. Members are getting calls at home. Cigna's calling to see if we just want to call and help you with something. Would you mind calling us back? And nobody calls Cigna back. You know, why is Cigna calling me? What are they after? It's a coach literally calling them because they've seen some claim come through that might have been a high glucose or a prescription drug that is indicative of some condition. So a coach is going to call them, and we need to get those people in touch. Oh, absolutely.
So nobody needs to know.
That's correct. It is confidential. No reporting is done back to the county on an individual basis. It's only aggregate reporting. Yeah.
Thank you, Paul.
That was one of my last questions, Mr. Chairman. If we do adopt this, could we add it, just like with the MedPoint clinics, could we add it as an item on every monthly report so we can track it and see if it's being successful?
The reporting on a monthly basis is not going to give you much information. So this is a first program after the pilot. I've got about one slide of information that I can prepare that'll basically just give us the idea of those who started the program and how many weeks they're through it. And we can add that possibly, but that's going to be about it for now.
I know it would probably take you time to build the information as you get participants, but I would like to know how many are participating, how many are being successful, you know, what are you retaining month to month? Are you replacing those with new people or different people signing up? Because I know you said it can kind of be an ongoing thing. I'd just like to know if it's working.
Yeah.
And definitely something to revisit a year from now to see, are we getting our return
Absolutely.
That we suspect that we are?
And this will be part of our quarterly reports that we analyze.
Yeah, I think with everything that has to fall into place, I think we had, January 1 as far as starting the program with the new health program coming in, new year starting, in other words.
Okay, thank you, Paul. Any other business to come for us? Thank each and every one of you for attending today. Welcome to our new members. Hope you kind of getting engaged, and we look forward to seeing you back next month. So I'll entertain a motion to adjourn. Got a motion to adjourn, and there's a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye or standing up. All opposed.